Hello once again, welcome to chapter number 7. In this chapter, you will learn fundamental concepts related to market structures, as well as important tools to measure industry concentration, market conditions, and market power. So let's start with a basic idea. Market structure refers to factors such as the number of firms that compete in a market, the relative size of the companies, this is what we call concentration, the technological and production cost conditions that characterize companies in the market, the market conditions itself, such as how elastic or inelastic the demand is, the barriers to entry to the market, could be patents or technological barriers, and some others. Now, different markets have different market structures, and of course they affect the decisions that managers make. This is why it's very important to understand the kind of market structure that you operate in. Let's start with the concept of market or industry concentration by looking at two main tools. First is the four firm concentration ratio, which measures how much of the total output in a given industry is produced by the largest four companies in the industry. The closer this ratio is to zero, the less concentrated is the industry. The closer the ratio is to one, the more concentrated the industry is. The second tool is the Herfindahl-Hirschman Index, which measures the industry concentration for the entire industry, not just the first four. When the index reaches 10,000, it means that a single company exists in the industry. That's what we call a monopoly. Thus, a value closer to zero means a less concentrated industry. Market concentration tools provide a very crude measure of the size structure of an industry. This could give us a good idea of what are the main players in a given market, how tough competition might be, and even a notion of the profit margin that companies make. For example, in this table, you can see that the furniture and related products market is less concentrated than, say, the distilleries market. As a general rule, companies in more concentrated industries enjoy a higher degree of market power, which means more control over market prices, which, of course, can be translated into higher profit levels. However, as useful and powerful as they are, these concentration measures have some limitations. First, the data published by the US Census Bureau is based on American companies only. In other words, imports from abroad are excluded. Second, the market concentration data available is at the national level only, but we know sometimes the relevant market for your company is only regional. This could be city, county, or state level, for example. And third, official data is highly aggregated and therefore doesn't always reflect the variety of goods or services in any given market. So use these data and tools with some caution. Technology and cost are other important factors determining the market structure. Some industries employ labor intensively, while others employ capital intensively. This, of course, has important implications for production cost. If companies utilize similar technology, they typically exhibit similar cost structures. But if companies within the same industry employ different technology, their cost structure will be different as well, and of course, competitiveness will differ across companies as well. The market demand is yet another factor, since low demand may imply few firms in the industry, while high demand may imply many firms competing for consumers. One way to measure the sensitivity to price of a product group as a whole relative to the sensitivity of the industry demanded of a single company to a change in its price, it's called the Rothschild Index. This index is basically a ratio of price elasticities of demand, specifically the elasticity for the whole market divided by the elasticity for the product of the firm. When R equals 1, the product and the market are equally sensitive to price changes. But if R is less than 1, it means that the product is more sensitive to price changes than the market as a whole. When that happens, your pricing strategy must be crafted more carefully. In this table, for example, you can see that the company producing food faces a more elastic demand than all food companies combined. Consult your textbook for a numerical example of this index. Sometimes companies are willing to enter new markets, but this is not always possible due to barriers to entry. For example, some companies don't have enough capital to make the required investment to enter the market. Or sometimes they simply can't because an existing patent legally protects the existing company or companies that hold it. Or sometimes a company wishing to enter the industry is not competitive enough because it's unable to exploit economies of scale and therefore its cost structure is not efficient enough. Another important factor that can have an impact on market structure is the ability of companies to control the market price. One way to measure this is called the Lerner Index, which is a measure of the difference between the price charged by the company and marginal cost as a fraction of the product's price. If L, the Lerner Index, is 0, it means no control over price, and therefore buyers pay a price equal to marginal cost. But if L is larger than 0, it means that the company has some control over price and it can charge a price above marginal cost. Another way to see this results from rearranging the equation and solving for price. Consult your textbook for a numerical example. Industry activity also involves companies' integration through mergers, for example, when two or more companies unite or merge into a single firm. Integration is an important factor determining market structure, since mergers often take place to reduce production or transaction costs, or to achieve economies of scale and therefore increase efficiency, or to increase market power and thus gain some ability to control market prices, or for many other reasons. Integration can be vertical when various stages of the production of a single good or service are carried out in a single company. Or integration can be horizontal when merging two or more similar final products into a single firm. A more complex merger takes place through a conglomerate merger, which is the integration of two or more different product lines into a single firm. Now, in a knowledge-driven economy, companies must constantly be innovating and positioning themselves at the forefront of technology. This implies research and development, R&D for short, which are expenditures made by firms to gain a technological advantage, mostly with the aim of acquiring a patent. As seen in this table, companies in some industries spend sizable amounts in R&D as a percentage of sales. Similarly, firms must constantly reach out to their customer base through advertisement, which are expenditures made by firms to inform or persuade consumers to purchase their products. As seen in this table, companies in some industries also spend sizable amounts in advertising as a percentage of sales. The point is that both expenditures in R&D and advertising can have an important impact on the market structure. In summary, the structured conduct performance paradigm, and you can see what this means in your textbook, holds that the level, growth, and sustainability of industry profits depends on five large factors: barriers to entry, the market power of buyers and suppliers of inputs, the level of competition and rivalry within the industry, and the number of complement and substitute goods and services available in the market. In the next few chapters, we will discuss in more detail four major market structures: perfect competition, monopoly, monopolistic competition, and oligopoly. So stay tuned. Okay, this concludes chapter 7 lecture. Until the next chapter.